I'd like to welcome everyone on behalf of the Berkeley Law School and the Center for Latin American Studies. We're very pleased and very honored to be jointly sponsoring this event this afternoon. Dean Christopher Edley of the Law School unfortunately had a prior commitment, but I very much would like to recognize the role he and the law school have played in the visit of Professor, of President Ricardo Lagos to Berkeley over the last 2 weeks. He has been teaching a special seminar here that has been co-sponsored by the law school and by the Center for Latin American Studies. And I'd also like to recognize the unusual, very thoughtful, and engaged role that Dean Edley has played on a range of issues in relation to Latin America. This is part of a seminar series of three seminars that we are doing with the University of Chile, the School of Economics and Business, on the theme of inequality. We know what kind of a critical issue it is in the United States today. It is absolutely as critical an issue throughout Latin America and certainly in Chile. This event will be on the web of the Center for Latin American Studies tomorrow afternoon. The remaining two events in the series will be webcast live with a speaker in Berkeley, a speaker in Chile, and an audience interacting in both places. It is meant to be a dialogue on inequality that spans the hemisphere. I'm Harley Shaiken. I'm the chair of the Center for Latin American Studies, and I teach in the Graduate School of Education and the Department of Geography. We're very pleased to be here, and I want to introduce our two speakers today. We will begin with Professor Robert Reich, who is a professor in the Goldman School of Public Policy and was Secretary of Labor in the Clinton administration. Robert Reich, as I think you all know, has been an unusually thoughtful, forceful, and engaged voice on issues of broad political and economic significance, and particularly on the issue of inequality. He has also been a true friend and very engaged with the Center for Latin American Studies. And actually, he has been so engaged that after this seminar today, we will be calling you Professor Roberto Reich. And we're especially honored to have with us President Ricardo Lagos. He certainly needs no introduction. He played a critical, at times heroic, role in bringing the return of democracy to Chile, at times at great personal cost. He was a transformative president of Chile from the year 2000 to 2006. We're very pleased and very honored that he's been with us these several weeks, teaching a special seminar and engaging in this public event today, and he will be speaking about his memoir. The title of the talk is A Memoir About the Future at 6 p.m. on Thursday, this Thursday, in 105 Stanley Hall on the Berkeley campus. Our format is going to be very straightforward. We're going to begin with Professor Reich, and he will speak, give a brief overview of inequality. We will then go to President Lagos. After these initial presentations, they are going to engage on the issue, and then we're going to open it up to questions from the audience and questions that we've received over the internet. So please join me in welcoming Professor Robert Reich. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Harleo, and Mr. President. I'm thrilled to be here, and I The issues of inequality in the hemisphere, particularly kind of comparing what's happened to the United States over the last 3.5 decades to what's happening elsewhere and what's happened elsewhere. And Chile is a very interesting case because of some history that we will get into, is one that hopefully you will find illuminating. Let me do my best in the limited time I have. I have about an hour and a half to make my, so no, I have about 15 minutes. I teach a course that goes an entire term, and we barely scratch the surface in the course. So don't expect very much in the next 15 minutes. But let me at least get to 2 points, and I'll leave out the third. The first point is, what happened? What has happened to the U.S. economy in terms of inequality, particularly over the last 35 years? And secondly, why did it happen? I may get a little bit to the third point, which is, why is it a problem? I'm definitely not going to get to the fourth point, which is, what can we do about it? Although I would love to, but you've got to take my course if you really want to know that fourth. What has happened? Basically, if you look at productivity gains since the Second World War, the United States has been fairly consistent, and the trajectory of productivity has been upward. The economy has grown. And as you know, economic growth is a product both of productivity gains and also population gains. And the productivity and population gains in the United States over the time, 3 decades of the second, after the Second World War, were very, very impressive. But what was perhaps most impressive in those years is that everybody gained. In fact, the bottom 20% economically gained more and faster than the top 20%. The bottom 10% gained more over those years and faster than the percentage gain of the top 10%. In other words, we moved toward equality. Not equality of result, equality of opportunity. There was much more to be done. I mean, in those years, we struggled over the issue of civil rights. We struggled over the issue of women's rights, particularly in the workforce. We are still struggling with these issues, but at least in those 3 decades, we made some headway on them. 1964, the Civil Rights Act, 1965, Voting Rights Act, and onward and onward and upward. But then something interesting and perplexing happened. In the late 1970s, although productivity and growth continued at more or less the same trajectory, there was a giant U-turn in the U.S. economy. No longer did we see every economic group essentially share in the gains from productivity. In fact, quite the contrary. Beginning in the late 70s, there was almost no sharing of the productivity gains with anybody but those at the very top. The median wage, and the median, I hasten to remind you, is different from average. Shaquille O'Neal, the basketball player, and I have an average height of 6 feet. You see, the top brings up the average. But the median, where you have half above and half below, the median wage began to stagnate. And male workers, particularly, we saw male median wage stagnating and actually declining, adjusted for inflation. Over the last 10 years, the male median wage has actually dropped considerably. A typical male worker today in the United States is earning, adjusted for inflation, less than he did 30 years ago. Women began to earn more, but remember, women came into the workforce in droves, beginning in the late 70s and 1980s, into the paid workforce. They'd always been working into the paid workforce, and I'm talking about middle class, lower middle class, and working class women. Poor women were in the paid workforce already, but they came into the workforce beginning in the late 1970s and 80s, and increasingly the 90s, not so much because there were all these wonderful new opportunities for women. But the major reason that women went into paid work in those years was to prop up declining family incomes, declining because the male wages were stagnating or dropping. And then we saw another phenomenon in the late 1990s, and certainly through the first 7 years of this century, we saw the way middle class, lower middle class, working class, and many poor families kept up spending was because and by means of their home equity loans and refinancing, using the fact that home prices were going up as a vehicle for keeping the cash flow up. But of course, this was not sustainable. And in 2007, 2008, the debt bubble and the housing bubbles burst. And now we are seeing a very slow, anemic recovery. Why? I think the primary reason is that the vast middle class and all of the people aspiring to become part of that middle class don't have the purchasing power they need to keep the economy going. More and more of the resources, the income, the wealth in the economy has been going to the very top. And when I say this sometimes, particularly to audiences that are not necessarily Berkeley audiences, I'm accused of being a class warrior. And I want to assure you, I'm not a class warrior. I'm not blaming anybody for this. If anything, I'm a class warrior, W-O-R-R-I-E-R. I worry that we're not going to be able to get out of the economic doldrums without enough aggregate demand, and the major source of aggregate demand in the United States is that vast middle class and aspiring middle class. If all the resources and income and wealth go to the top, they simply don't spend as much of their incomes. That's what it means to be rich. You have most of what you need. The other thing I worry about is that with income and wealth going to the top, we also are seeing political power going to the top. And in this election, and we saw it beginning several elections ago, but after the Supreme Court's grotesque decision in Citizens United against the Federal Election Commission, added to other Supreme Court decisions that have said in the past, speech is money under the First Amendment, well, what you have essentially is opening the gates to an extraordinary amount of money, a lot of it coming from vested interests, both individuals, billionaires, and also corporations, Wall Street executives, who have a primary interest in making sure that their incomes, their wealth, and their privilege are entrenched. That's why you have a tax code that, instead of the tax, marginal tax we had in the first three decades after the Second World War, on the top, which was a very high marginal tax. I mean, even if you get rid of all deductions and consider all deductions and all of the tax credits, the highest marginal tax rates in those years paid by the richest Americans was about 54%. Now we are having this big debate over whether we want to go to the Bill Clinton tax rate of 35% or stick with the George Bush tax rate. And even that is fallacious because most millionaires are getting most of their money out of capital gains. And that means that they have a tax rate of 15%. And if you're Mitt Romney, your tax rate is 13% on $20 million a year. What did we do right in those years, the first three decades after the Second World War? Well, it wasn't just pent-up demand from the Second World War. And it wasn't just the fact we didn't have much international competition. Those did contribute to it. But more importantly, we invested in education, in job training, in higher education, public higher education, a GI Bill that allowed returning veterans to educate themselves essentially for free at colleges and universities. We invested substantially in infrastructure, the interstate highway system. I mean, Dwight D. Eisenhower, who nobody would accuse of being a socialist, presided over an extraordinary degree of public investment, at the same time, at least nominally, the highest tax rates on the highest income earners were 91% under the Eisenhower administration. I mean, can you imagine a Republican administration today, or even a Democratic administration, coming nearly that close? And then in 1965, Medicare, we expanded all sorts of social safety nets that really in those days functioned more like trampolines for many people who were in the workforce, such as a reinvigorated unemployment insurance system and a job training system. Anybody who fell out of the system could get back into the system, and the economy was growing so fast that jobs were plentiful. In other words, we married mass consumption to mass production, but it wasn't just stuff. And people, when I talk about aggregate demand, people often say, well, do you really want an economy where people are just buying more and more stuff? No.
When you have a growing economy that is premised on widening the circle of prosperity, it means that you can do things that you otherwise can't do in terms of moving toward environmental protection. That's what we have, the Environmental Protection Act of 1970. We could expand Medicare and Medicaid, and we could provide child health. We could do many things that were of a non-material nature that improved all of our well-beings because the economy was growing so fast and because prosperity was widespread. We are no longer doing that and can no longer do that. Do I have time to get into my final point? Where is our timekeeper? Yes, I do. Why did things turn around? Why that great U-turn beginning in the late 1970s in the United States? Well, primarily, it's correlated. Causation is not necessarily the same as correlation, but primarily, it seems to me, it's caused by a combination of globalization and technological change. By the late 70s, early 1980s, many other places around the globe could do things as cheaply and almost as productively as we could, particularly when and to the extent they had access to our same technologies. And we saw new technologies come on stream. Cargo ships, container ships, satellite communication technologies, and then eventually computers and the internet, which allowed the production process to be further parceled out around the world wherever it could be done most cheaply. But moreover, technology started displacing workers. You remember we used to have a lot of bank tellers? We used to have a lot of people who were gas station attendants and did a lot of service work. Well, they were automated. We used to have things called trade unions. Now, for young people, that may sound quaint. Only 7%, in fact, fewer than 7% of our private sector workers are today unionized. But we had, in the 1950s and through the early 1960s, almost a third of all workers in the United States were unionized, which gave them enormous bargaining leverage to claim a share, a substantial share, of the productivity gains. And that was a virtuous cycle, because as they claimed more and more of those gains, then those gains became part of the fabric of our economy. They turned around and bought things, they paid taxes, they supported a government that could in turn make public investments. But once trade unions started to wither on the vine, right now, again, almost in the private sector, no bargaining leverage at all, we saw a reversal of that. Middle class, lower middle class, their wages and the decline of the median wage tracks almost exactly the decline of trade union membership in the United States. Also, we saw a decline and have seen a decline in the minimum wage. That's more a symptom, but it has a causal element because you have got a lot of women in the workforce, poor women, working class women, who need a higher minimum wage. But if the minimum wage today were what it was in 1968, adjusted for inflation, today it would be $10 an hour instead of $7.25. We saw in our society generally a slowdown in public investment, particularly K through 12, and especially higher education. The percentage of the population graduating with four-year college degrees began to level out in the late 1970s, late 1980s. It still is increasing, but it is not increasing at nearly the rate it was increasing before that point. There are many things, another, which we could have done as a society to deal with these changes in technology and globalization without all turning into neo-Luddites and trying to smash the machinery, which I don't recommend. But we did not do it. Politically, we did not have the will to make the kinds of public investments necessary. We didn't have the will to make sure that the unionized sector of our workforce, particularly in service sectors that were sheltered from international competition, could continue to grow. We didn't have the will to maintain high marginal taxes on those who are best able to pay them in this society. We didn't have the political will to do many other things that we could have done and should have done to prepare our workers to do better. Other countries, and the easiest example is Germany, have higher median wages than we do, more manufacturing, and also more exports. It can be done. This is not a matter of economic determinism. This is a matter of failure, of political will, and I wish I could go on. But I must stop. Thank you very much.
President Ricardo Lagos.
All right. I thought that you were going to introduce me like Richard Lakes. But anyhow, let me tell you that I'm extremely happy to be here to share with the audience and with Professor Reich. It's just wonderful to listen to him, the clarity in the way that he exposed his views. My only problem, that I have a sympathy almost 100% of what normally he says. So what I'll try to do now is to say, look, my starting point is lower. Lower in the sense that Latin American per capita income is much lower than United States per capita income. And let me tell you that even though Latin America during the last decade has had a tremendous growth rate, above 5% per year, the crisis stopped that in 2009, but we recovered in 2010, and now we are back with about 5% on the average per year. At the same time, Latin America is emerging from this crisis in a different mood. For the first time, we feel confident. We are not responsible for the first time of an economic crisis. We are innocent in this crisis. All the others normally start in Latin America. The Mexican crisis, the tequila crisis, the Brazilian crisis, etc. The Argentinian crisis, of course. But now it's a different one. Nevertheless, because we have been able to have growth, well, we have been able to reduce, again, the average from something like 45% of families in Latin America living under the poverty line to something like 34% now. And there has been a lot of advances reducing poverty. Needless to say, I'm going to a commercial now. In 20 years ago, 23 years ago in Chile, when democracy was recovered, 45% of our family were living under the poverty line. So what was going to be the number one in the agenda during those days, with 5,000 per capita income, PPP, during those days? To defeat poverty. How to reduce poverty? That was the number one question. And therefore, all the efforts were in two directions. First, to have growth, and second, to make sure that part of that growth was going to be in favor of those that has less. So you learn, after a while, how to focalize where are the poverty group. If you have a female that is the chief of the household, you bet that they are going to be poor. Therefore, all social benefits start saying for females, chief of a household. So you learn to focalize, you have growth, and at the very end, you are able to reduce poverty. And during the first 10 years, we reduce poverty from those 45% to something like 22. But in the late years, in the past decade, in the last decade of the 20th century, well, our growth was declining because of the Asian crisis, and we have some problems. And the fact was that poverty remained at the level of 20%. And we learned the hard way that the tools to reduce poverty from 40 to 20 are extremely useful for 40 to 20. But from 20 to decrease that, we need different tools. And this is what we did. And now there's a big discussion in Chile about numbers of poverty, but let us say that poverty is around 11% according to United Nations. So we have been able and succeed from 40 to 11, or 13 if you prefer the other figures. But the question is, but the question is that we discover, it's nothing to discover about, that is one thing to defeat poverty and quite another to improve distribution of income. Those are two quite different things. So, let me tell you what is the second point that I would like to make. That in the process of going from $5,000 per capita income to $15,000 per capita, or today in Chile is about 18. 18 also is about the situation in Uruguay, Argentina, depending on what figure are you going to use. But there is no question that given the rate of growth of Brazil, Mexico, Colombia, Peru, all those countries, including Chile, Uruguay, Argentina, are going to be above the 20,000 PPP per capita income, I would say, during the next, according to the IMF, during the next 5 to 8 years more. And here is my point. All recent experience will tell you that there is a very close correlation in the way that was presented by Professor Reich, of course, when you are going to up in per capita income and with good public social policies well focalized, and you can reduce poverty. We learned that. Nevertheless, this close correlation between going up per capita income and reducing social and economic inequalities, or improving the economic indicators in these areas, is a very close correlation. Therefore, it's useful to have increases in per capita income. The problem is that all the studies show that when you are above the $20,000 per capita income yardstick, then the correlation doesn't work as well as it used to work before that. And what we discover is that New Zealand, a developed country with something like $23,000-$25,000 per capita income, has much better social and economic indicators than the United States. We discovered that the longest life expectancy in the world is Japan, with about 20% less per capita income than the United States. And let me tell you, another commercial, that in our case, our life expectancy is approaching very rapidly to the life expectancy of the United States. And needless to say, the difference in per capita income. Why I'm saying this? Because now it's very clear that if you want to explain what are the difference in social and economic indicators, life expectancy, infant mortality rate, what about the level of mobility in a particular society, what about the number of homicides per 100,000, what about the number of people in jail in a particular country? Obesity? Even, what about girls being pregnant between 15 to 20 years of age? All those social indicators are closely related to distribution of income. And therefore, the big issue is that the best indicator with regard to social and economic indicators beyond 20,000 is not going to be per capita income. It's going to be how that income is distributed in that country. And if that is going to be the yardstick to see how are we, Latin Americans, going to be able to live in the near future when we are above those figure, let me tell you, we are the worst continent to live. Because we have been quite successful vis-a-vis reducing poverty, but still, our distribution of income is one of the worst in the world. The worst as a continent. And let me tell you that Chile disputes with Brazil, who is the number one with the worst income distribution, not to be very proud of. And therefore, the big question is, why you didn't do anything when you were president? My goodness, and here you are talking in Berkeley. And then let me tell you very clear. We were able to reduce income inequality, transferring public goods to the lowest 20 or to the lowest 40% of our population. And the primary distribution of income, the highest 20%, the median income of the highest 20 versus the lowest 20, is 14 times in Chile. And we reduced that to about 8 times after we introduced what kind of elements are given to those people living under the 20%. So the 14 is reduced to 8. But 8 times is the difference in the United States. So we are not a very good company from that point of view. And what I'm trying to say is this. We exhausted most of the subsidies, most of the things that you can transfer, like public goods, to those that are in the bottom of our this income distribution. But we in Chile, like in the rest of Latin American countries, have the very doubtful privilege that our distribution of income before taxes and after taxes remains the same. Remains the same. Therefore, this is the major problem that now we are facing. Because it's not only that our tax pressure, this means the amount of taxation vis-a-vis our gross domestic product, is rather low, very low, with the only exception of Brazil, which is about 34%. All the rest Latin American countries, including Chile, is less than 20%. And therefore, if you are going to go from a country of $10,000 to $15,000 per capita income to something like 20 or 22 and 23, there's going to be a new demand. Those people that are living behind poverty, they don't want to go back. But they want to make sure that now they have different demands, that demands that they used to have when they were under the poverty line. This is the new emerging middle class. And that new emerging middle class, the demand number one is to have their kids being able to go to tertiary education, university or some other post-high school education. And this is the major problem that you can see in my country when you have today those student demonstrations. Why? Simply because we used to have 200,000 students at the university level in 1990, and now we have 1.1 million students 20 years later. Now, of 10 university students, 7 is first generation in their families that are going to be a student at the university level. First generation in their family. That's a tremendous change. The only problem that you have to pay tuition. And therefore, the big issue is, are you going to be able to keep a system in Chile by which the university is only for those that can afford? Or are you going to introduce a system of scholarship or whatever it's going to be in order either to have free tuition for those? And most of the people protesting now are people that belong to this emerging middle class. Why? Because if you are among the lowest 20%, you get a scholarship. If you are in the second or third level, then you will not. And this is where you have the problem. In short, now we face two major problems. How are you going to have a different tax system in order to make redistribution of income through taxation to begin with? Number two, how are you going to be able to devote those increases in income in order to have a fair society? It's true. We put a lot of emphasis to have growth and to reduce poverty. Now, because we succeed, then we have a different economic cycle, a different economic challenge, a different economic process to deal with. And this is why I think that now we have to learn a lot from the way that what has happened in this country and in some other countries. Because if here you went back, as Robert Reich said so brilliantly this morning or this afternoon, what can we do in order to improve our income distribution beginning now before we reach the yardstick of the 20,000? Because the question is, at the 20,000, where would you like to be? With those countries with better distribution of income or worse distribution of income? And let me tell you that the international comparison between developed countries, among developed countries, United States is not among that has the best, it's rather country that has the worst. Therefore, we would like to be in a position where we are going to be now. Our big challenge will be how we are going to be able to have growth with income distribution at the same time. In the past was poverty, now it's income distribution. Thanks a lot.
Professor Reich, do you have a question you'd like to pose to President Lagos?
Well, I have many questions. Mr. President, that was brilliant, and it's an honor, true honor, to share the stage with you. I have a question for you about ideology and philosophy. Because I think there's an interesting historical connection between Chile and the United States. And it has to do with ideology and philosophy. In the United States, starting in the 1950s and beginning in the 60s, but really reaching a climax with the election of Ronald Reagan in 1980 and then 81, we had the triumph of a certain philosophy, which for want of a better word might be called supply-side economics, or trickle-down economics, as it was called. Unfortunately, nothing trickled down.
But
the idea, in a nutshell, was to deregulate markets, to privatize, to fight trade unions, and also at the same time to provide tax breaks for the very rich. I am simplifying, of course. And that formula did seem to unleash the stock market and did generate enormous efficiencies. But as it was applied, beginning with a vengeance, beginning here in the 1980s, that formula absolutely led and contributed to widening inequality. Now, here's the question for you, and I'm sorry it's taken me a little bit long to get there, because that same philosophy came, if there was an epicenter, if there was a mind and a group that represented that and that infected their views, or at least spread their views to the Reagan administration and on, it came from the University of Chicago. Milton Friedman, his disciples, the Chicago Boys. Now, in the 60s and 70s, those Chicago Boys, as they were then called, under the aegis of the United States government, including the CIA, went to Chile. They worked hard, they came up with a blueprint
for deregulating, for privatizing, for fighting unions, for providing tax cuts for the wealthy, for doing all of that. And then Milton Friedman actually traveled to Chile in 76, and met with Pinochet, who committed to doing even more of that. Some people of conservative bent in the United States looking back would say those ideas were responsible for the Chilean economic miracle. What do you think?
I don't think so. I think that, thank you very much for the question. During the 60s, there was two kind of agreements. The Catholic University Economics Department student going down to Chicago, and the student from the University of Chile coming with the agreement Chile, California, with the University of California and several campuses. But needless to say that you are correct, because right after the coup, it was the Chicago boys that has been trained in Chicago, those that were mostly in power, and they introduced the changes that you described. And I think that in the late 80s, the so-called Washington Consensus emerged with the 10 famous commandments that you had to improve, the one that you mentioned. And the only problem that Williamson, that coined the word the Washington Consensus, recognized, that the only thing that they didn't did was to realize that growth was not only enough, because growth is not always going to trickle down to the rest. And therefore, what we have been doing once democracy returned was, it's true, we have a balanced fiscal budget. It's true, I introduced a structural surplus for our fiscal budget, in a sense that we are going to spend more when copper prices go down, and when copper prices are going up, then we have to save for the, during the sunny days, for the, when there's going to be rainy days. But much more important, let me tell you, I think that the Chicago boys think that a society has to be shaped according to market forces. And that is the trickle down. And all of us here in this room are consumers. And as consumers, we shape what society are we going to be living in. The only problem I used to say is that as consumers, our pocket is different from one consumer to the next one. And therefore, a society that is shaped by market forces is going to reproduce the unevenness of the market consumer purchasing power. Therefore, I think that in a democracy, there are a few goods and services that are extremely important to be given to the market, like education, or health, or the pension system. Housing, drinkable water. Yes, I know drinkable water is based in a city. You just plug into. But in the rural areas, it's not so simple. And in the rural areas, cost $1,000, $2,000, up to $3,000 per family for them to have rural drinkable water. Can they pay that? They cannot. Should we provide drinkable water? If the citizens say yes, then you have to do it. In other words, I think that the divided line are those that think that the market society is going to be shaped by market forces, that means the consumers, and I think that the other line of thinking says that a society is going to be shaped according to the views of the citizens. All of us are citizens. Are all of us as citizens are equal. And it's up to the citizens to decide in the 20th century in Chile that after 20 years, Well, compulsory education has to be implemented for just 4 years in the early 20th century. And that was a citizen decision, not the market. Now, after, well, Chile was improving, another commercial, till 2003, you can think who was president by that time, and the decision was compulsory education 12 years. And we've been it, and it's there. Okay, but that's a decision of the citizens. So I like to use what Bobbio used to say, the Italian a philosopher that say, I think that in a democracy, all of us has to be equal in something. That all of us is the minimum civilizatorio. And needless to say, that minimum is increasing as is increasing the materials, goods, and services of that society. And it's up to the citizens to make that definition, not the market forces, not the consumer. And I think that another way to define a democratic system is the system that allows the citizens to define the society, characteristic of that society, where they would like to live in. And this is what we have been trying to accomplish during those years, because we don't believe in the trickle-down. Now, if you talk me about some other issues, I think very much what you say in terms of what happened with globalization. But the big issue here is, what kind of globalization are we going to have? A globalization where everything can transfer from one place to another, making just like this in a computer. And the only thing that cannot go from one place to another are human beings. So everything is globalized with the only exception of human beings. And as Carlos Fuentes, the Latin American novelist, fortunately died very recently, like to say, in Latin America, all of us are migrants. All of us. Some migrants arrived 30,000 years ago through the Strait of Bering. No papers, of course, were required. Some other migrants arrived, you know, from Spain 500 years ago. Others from the African continent. In short, all of us are migrants. And now it so happened that we would like to send back a few migrants that we received from Europe. Europe is not accepting us. And most of those living south used to be living north when they were coming through the Strait of Bering. And now we are trying to send them back to north, and we have some problem here. Let me tell you, I think, to conclude, I think that this issue of migration cannot be dealt as a domestic issue. It should be dealt as a multilateral issue. But that's another story. In short, I thank you for your question, and let me ask you one question now. Till what extent the description that you gave about the United States mainly is due to political factors? Thatcher and Reagan, they changed the conventional wisdom. Keynes has been revival now because of the crisis. But till what extent this political element, this political ingredient that were so strong, shaping the economic policies in the United States during the last 30 years, will have a revisiting of those ideas given what happened with the economic crisis? Or are we going to be back business as usual right after the crisis is over?
I don't know. But let me give try to give you an educated guess, Mr. President. Undoubtedly, the philosophy of Reagan and Thatcher and Milton Friedman did take root and flower in the United States, as it did to a lesser extent in Chile, in the late 70s and in the 80s. And even to a large extent today, we still have that same philosophy. Now, you could say that one reason that philosophy took such root is because the habits of social connection, social cohesion that we had developed and learned through the Depression, which basically was extraordinarily widespread in the United States. One out of four families, the breadwinner was unemployed. Everybody was hit by the Depression. And then the Second World War, which again was a, no one would have wanted, would have wished it on anyone and any country, but it did generate a substantial degree of social cohesion. Living off of those two experiences, in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, we understood our responsibilities to one another as citizens of the United States. We understood that we were very much in the same boat, that the rising tide lifted all boats. John F. Kennedy repeated that over and over and over again. But it could be that the reason that Thatcher and Reagan and Milton Friedman and that kind of philosophy, which is not we're all in the same boat, we're not all in it together, you're on your own. That philosophy may have been able to take root because a whole generation had forgotten the Depression and the Second World War. So the question, to put your question in a slightly different context, is whether the economic crisis that begins in 2008, that we are still suffering, and we are still suffering the gravitational pull of that crisis, could that be enough to reignite a sense of solidarity, we're all in it together, and give President Obama, in what is sure to be his second term, the mandate he needs to do something bolder, to spread prosperity. And I think that's a question that we can't know the answer to yet. But the irony for Obama, and here is the paradox, the irony, had he not acted as he did, both to save the financial system and to stimulate the economy and forestall another Great Depression. Had he not done that, and had we fallen into another Great Depression, he might ironically have had the kind of political will at his back that Franklin D. Roosevelt had to do something far bolder than he actually was able to do after that point. It may be that if he does get a second term, or if this terrible economy falls into a recession and it continues, either the country comes together and we decide we do have to spread prosperity because that's the only way we get enough aggregate demand, we have the social cohesion, the social health that we need to move forward, or it could go in the opposite direction. It could be that people are so angry and so frustrated that they begin listening to demagogues who point the finger of blame at immigrants, at foreigners, at the poor, at the rich, at gays, at women, at various people who have obviously nothing to do with the crisis, but are easy scapegoats. We don't know yet.
Given your answer, the answer will be given by the American citizens next November.
And next November is coming very soon.
Well, with that, I had actually prepared a brief monologue, not with one, but with 12 empty chairs. But because we're a little tight on time, we'll go directly to questions from the audience. We would ask that you keep the question very brief so we can have as full a discussion as possible. Yes.
Yes. Given that we humans are primates and the social hierarchies, regarding the inequality, regarding this issue of inequality, I want to ask you both: what is we have these examples, New Zealand, maybe Scandinavia, where these indexes of difference are relatively low. And then we have these spectacular other cases led, in my mind, by the U.S. right today, based on recent changes. What is a goal, what is a way of thinking of this, of what would be an optimal, not just improved, as you mentioned, we've had ups and downs, but is there a goal, I guess, let me put it this way, in talking about inequality where we say, oh, the bottom 10% and the top 10% differ by just take their incomes factor of 2 instead of a factor of 5,000 or whatever it is. Can you speak to that issue? What are we, is our sight looking not just the day-to-day struggle, but say, here is an optimum that where humans could thrive if socially across the society, what is that level of difference between the bottom and the top?
Do you want to go first or shall I?
Well, it's very difficult to say what's going to be the difference, should be the difference between, ideally, between the bottom and the and those that are down the scale. Nevertheless, you can have some guess. If the United States is about 8 times, and the other end of the scale is Japan, with something like 3.6 times, then, beginning with 4 to 5, you have there the Scandinavian countries, as you say. And 5 something, close to 6, is around the European countries. So those are the yardstick. Another way, of course, is the, there are many ways to measure income distribution, as you know, is the Gini coefficient. And this, with regard to the Gini coefficient, most Latin American countries are around 0.52, 54, before and after taxes, while in the case of the OECD countries, in OECD countries, the difference are what? Before taxes, it's about 0.48, 46 on the average, OECD countries. After taxes, it's reduced to 0.29. That's a huge difference between after taxes or before taxes. And this is where I think is a pending task from our own point of view. But the numbers are rather clear. The question is the political will. When you have a movement in the United States like the 1% movement or the 99% movement, by the way, 99 versus the 1, who is going to win? Very obvious, who is going to win? Nevertheless, apparently things are not so clear. So the question about the political will at the very end, I think, is the most important one.
Yes, I don't have much to add to that except to say that the real thrust toward inequality in this country has not been so much the top 10% versus the bottom 10% or the top 20 versus the bottom 20%. It's really been the top 1% or the top 0.1% and everybody else. The most dramatic reality we have been facing in terms of inequality is that the top 1% is now taking home more than 20% of total income and has about 40% of total wealth in this country. The 400 richest Americans have more wealth than the bottom 150 million put together. We are so far from what we were in the first 3 decades of after the Second World War, that merely aspiring to go back to what we had then would be, it seems to me, enough of a goal, enough of an aspiration. In those years, there was certainly enough incentive to grow. People who argue in favor of inequality say, well, obviously we're unequal, you have to have a lot of inequality, or at least substantial inequality, to provide incentives to people to invest and to invent and to work hard, and that to some extent is correct. But in those 3 decades, we grew faster per year on average, even though we had far greater equality. The top 1% taking home about 10% of total income, as opposed to 20% today, than we have had in the last 3 decades. So why not simply aim for approximately what we had in those first 3 decades?
One brief question from the internet. This is coming from San Jose del Cabo, Mexico, and politics has been running through the last several remarks. The question is, given how does any country with embedded injustice achieve equality? In other words, how do you fix the problem of injustice without destabilizing a country?
I think it's the other way around. Mm-hmm. I think that the idea is to have social cohesion. The idea is how much cohesive is a society. how much people realize that if the country is growing, this is not because the president or the prime minister is saying, look, our growth rate was the last year 5%, but that you can see that growth because now you have a better school, a better primary health care center, a better housing, a better social pensions or whatsoever, a better judicial system. The big issue is when you are talking every day about how much growth you have, and you see all things exactly the same for the most of the people. And therefore, the question is, how are you going to be able to take the political decision that you require to take? I know that this is difficult. I know that Congress normally are rather conservative. Normally, those that are better off wouldn't like to have changes. And especially when you're talking about taxes. As Galbraith used to say, whenever you talk about taxes, well, the poor smile because think that something big came upon him, and the rich are extremely afraid because something is going to take me out. And therefore, I understand that. But unless you have leadership, unless you explain that, in some cases you have to take your case to the people. Otherwise, you are not going to change things. I say that the president is the number one in many things, but the most important one is the major communicator in the country. And sometimes, of course, you are with the flag. It's your duty as a president. But sometimes you have to take up your sleeve and go to fighting if you want to introduce your new ideas and to have majority. When are you going to fight? And when are you going to be covered with the flag? Well, that's a political, very difficult to do. But you have to do it. And if you don't, then you can lose. Because you don't clarify what are the differences. And at the end, politics is to make a difference. And a president, at the very end of the day, the only thing that the president is supposed to do is to take choices, make decisions. This is what they are for. Sometimes a difficult decision, but you have to do it. To say no to President Bush in Iraq was not easy. But you have to do it because somebody thought that was a good idea to have Chile at that time in the Security Council.
And Mr. President, let me thank you for saying no to President Bush on Iraq. Harley, the only thing here I have to add is to suggest that we are not now living in a particularly stable system. That is, we are seeing more political and ideological divisiveness right now than we've had in living memory. We have more anger and frustration than we have had in many, many years. The Tea Party movement, what is left of, and I don't know where it's going, the Occupy movement, other groups have in common their sense that the country is not only off track, but that the establishment is not working for most people, and that there's some degree of collusion between business, big business, and government, big government, and Wall Street. And to some extent, obviously, anyone looking at the situation sees that there is. It is impossible for a government and for a president to lead, as the president said, without educating the public as to the extent of the problem, and in this case, the problem of inequality. And I thought President Obama did on December 6th in Kansas, when he gave a speech that, to me, was the best speech he has ever given. It was about inequality, and it was about the costs of inequality for this country. I wish that he had given a similar speech last Thursday night.
Well, clearly we are just beginning this conversation. Unfortunately, we are out of time. I want to thank everyone for coming. This will be on the web. We look forward to seeing you Thursday evening at 6 p.m. in 105 Stanley. And for the two remaining conversations, through the hemisphere on issues of inequality. I want to thank again Professor Robert Reich and President Ricardo Lagos.
You're wonderful.
You're good.
You're fabulous. And you are so respected.